This conference will now be recorded. This conference will now be recorded.
Good morning, everyone. Today, I'm going to speak on the topic Amavata. I think yesterday's topic is pending, and there was a repetition of Pandu, and I'll be dealing with the whole of the Amavata disease. Okay, so if you open Madhavanida, you'll be seeing this Amavata appearing in the 25th chapter. So Amavata is mentioned immediately after Purustambha. So there is a sequence behind mentioning of each and every disease. Okay, as you find in Bratrais, a similar kind is followed in Lagutrais also. Okay, Purustambha, a disease where it's afflicting the joints. Okay, and another important disease, what you are going to see in your OPDs will be Amavata. Okay, the sequence behind mentioning of this Amavata after Purustambha is for the same reason, as people can see and differentiate and better diagnose Amavata and differentiate it from Purustambha. So 25th chapter is contributed in the Madhavanida. Okay, you don't find this disease being mentioned in Charak Samhita, Sushruta or Ashtangrudai. You can find it in the Lagutrais, wherein the Nidana Panchakadi also being mentioned, and also the treatment aspect and all you are finding in the Lagutrais. Okay, in Brahatrais, it doesn't mean that the people were not suffering with Amavata. The people were suffering with Amavata, and you do find the mentioning of the word Amavata in different contexts. Say for example, in the Chikitsa Sthana, in the chapter Pandu Chikitsa, you can come across this word where the person has mentioned Fanta, Vishaladi Fanta, where he mentions the word Amavata. So similarly, you are going to find this Amavata in the context of Grahani being mentioned. Okay, so I think you got an idea what exactly you mean by this word Amavata, and you have been taking the cases since the second year has started. Okay, but the term is given by looking into the consequences, how the samprapti is framed. Okay, whereas in other conditions, say like sandhivata, the disease is named after the afflicting organ. Okay, but in the context of Amavata, the samprapti is so severe, or the samprapti happens to be more important than the exhibition of the clinical features, because the clinical features are not restricted only to the joints. The clinical features are there to the other systems other than the musculoskeletal system also. Okay, so for the same reason, the disease Amavata is named, and not taking into account any of the sandhis. You can see it is a disease which is afflicting the multiple systems. Okay, say for example, what exactly happens? Just come out of from this PPT and you just understand what exactly is Amavata and how the patient is exhibiting the clinical features. Okay, so what kind of people come or it is afflicting? So let us speak from the modern point of view. So in this, most of the time, many of the conditions related or what you are going to put in into the rheumatology or into the musculoskeletal system, okay, will be clubbed under the heading of Amavata. It is a broad term wherein you will be including many of the conditions. I think in during module of musculoskeletal system also I have said this. Okay, so you can include the things like the rheumatoid arthritis, lupus erythematosus, rheumatic fever, Sjogren's syndrome, Reiter's syndrome, or fibromyalgia. So many things are there which can be clubbed under the heading of Amuata. Okay, I don't go to equate the things. You learn Ayurveda as Ayurveda and learn the modern medicine in order to give answer to your patients and in order to understand what medicine they have taken from modern fraternity and come back to Ayurveda. And for different conditions, you need to have a better knowledge of modern science, better knowledge of modern science than Ayurveda to treat in an Ayurvedic way, right? So for that reason, you have to know which are the conditions which can be put under this broad heading of Amuata. Okay, that's one thing. How the patient exhibit the clinical features. Okay, so the cardinal features or the pratyatma lakshana or the complaints with what the patient come to you will be, the patient will be complaining of multiple joint pain. Okay, multiple, you understand the word multiple, because in the ward you are seeing the patients, you can see people with that what I can say janubasti being done. If you go in the afternoon to take the history on the bed, they will be there and with the janubasti being put on the knees. So that is another condition called as sandhivata, where the major joints are afflicted. But in Amuata you are seeing the multiple joints are being afflicted. You can see all the joints getting afflicted in these conditions, the smaller joints. So that is what you need to understand, smaller joints, that is hand joints or the foot joints, okay, and rest of the joints. So the author uses a very important terminology. Trik Sandhi is the term utilized by Madhavakara. So I think if I ask you the question, what is Trik Sandhi, you will always, most of the time, the students tell it is the sacrum. No, Trik Sandhi is the term. If you look into the commentary, you will understand what exactly you mean by this word Trik Sandhi. So Trik Sandhi is telling me something about the site where two or three bones are getting united. So in the context of sacrum also, you are seeing the bones being united to form the sacrum or the Trikasthi. But in this context, Trikasthi, you need to understand that two or three bones getting united to form the Sandhi. So for that matter, it is a wrist, knee joint, elbow joint, all the existing joints can be considered where Amuata is going to have its role. So the first complaint in this, the patient will be possessing multiple joint pain. Whenever there is a pain, it will be automatically followed with the swelling. Once there is swelling, there has to be rise in the temperature. I think very short time back we have seen the inflammation and its clinical features, right? Okay, and once there is increase in the local rise of temperature, you can see some kind of change on the skin. We call it as discoloration, pallor. Okay, so there is pain, there is swelling, there is local rise of temperature. Okay, there is again discoloration on the skin. So most of the time you are going to touch the joint and see, and then you are going to see the other parts of the body, whether the local rise of, and this is not one day program, you have to see a number of patients, then it will be probably possible for you to differentiate the local rise of temperature. Okay, so now your days you are seeing the gun being put into your head to look for the temperature. So that is not going to work here. You need to go for the clinical examination and look for the local rise of temperature or what. Got it? So you just bear in mind, Amavata is a condition where the patient will come with a complaint of multiple joint pain, sometimes swelling, sometimes local rise of temperature, okay, and sometime discoloration of the skin. Discoloration of the skin can be seen in a fair skinned person, not all the people of India for that matter, but still you can see if the person is fair skinned, the redness in and around the joints can be seen, and that can be included as a important clinical features. Okay, and the last what you can add is we have seen in the context of inflammation being like the pain or the swelling. Okay, rubor, tumor, calor, and all you have seen. And the fifth being added there as the loss of function. And similarly, in this context also, you are going to see the loss of function. Loss of function in the sense, there will be deformity. Deformities are being formed later on in the, as the disease continues, if the treatment is not proper and all, the patient will enter into a stage. okay, complications, upadrava, where the function of the joint is lost, wherein he develops a, what I can say, the deformity like the thumb, okay, swan neck deformity, button ear deformity, all these deformities can be seen, where fifth sign of inflammation can be seen. So I think that would be the better basic introduction to Amavata. Okay, this is what, and this is pertaining to the joint what I'm speaking, but the disease is named as Amavata. So you need to understand there is conglomeration of Ama and Vata, which is afflicting not only the musculoskeletal system, it is afflicting rest of the systems also. So the person will have aruchi, avipaka, agnimandya, ananabilasha, anidra, okay, and the divasvapna. Why the divasvapna is there if the person has ama and vata? Because of the disease and its influence, the patient feels more of sleep during the day. At night, because of pain, the person is awake. So he is not having any good pattern of sleep, and during day, due to sunlight, the person feels somewhat better in his complications or the complaints or his suffering. So you can see the people are feeling more of sleep during daytime. If you speak to the patients, you will understand, and the author is mentioning it as diva swapna. So always you are advising the patient not to go for diva swapna. That's another context. So you need to broadly understand how a disease is being exhibited with the clinical features, okay, and which are the other features which are not belonging to the musculoskeletal system. Okay, so I said something about the gastrointestinal tract, and I said something about the sleep pattern and all, where all other systems are being involved in the musculoskeletal system. So this is just an introduction to make you understand and bring you into this topic, because if you understand the samprapti, if you understand the pathophysiology of Amavata, you'll be a better practitioner to treat many of the autoimmune related disorders. Now we are dealing with the COVID-19, and to combat COVID-19, we are all dealing with immunity and all, and people are saying so many things about the immunity. And immunity is not a one-day program, and you cannot improve it just by simply drinking milk and haridra and all. That has to be practiced from childhood. It cannot be done in 3 months or something by just drinking and whatever you are saying, that all is not possible, but it needs a good homework. Right? So better late than never. Now at least we can start to improve our immunity. So many diseases related with autoimmunity, right, just like this Amavata or rheumatoid arthritis, you can treat so many things like autoimmune thyroiditis. So whenever you go to OPD, you get a lot of patients with a thyroid, where their all thyroid functions are normal, but clinically they are a patient of thyroid. So then what is your understanding from an Ayurvedic point of view? So the samprapti for that autoimmune thyroiditis and all remains in this chapter of Amavata. Got it? So it's better if you treat this, understand this, then the treatment happens to be better for many diseases. Not, I said something about the endocrinology, give an example of autoimmune thyroiditis. So similarly, you have got something like the respiratory system, where you are seeing the condition like the tamakashwasa, wherein you are going to see this kind of a sathinata. And then you can just jump to skin. There also you got something to learn in the context of Kushta, where autoimmunity and all those things are there, and asatmita happens to be the center. So in order to treat all the things or the asatmita which has developed in the body, you need to understand pathophysiology of Amavata. I think next year in Agada Tantra, you'll be coming across Dharavisha, Doshivisha and all, and how they are posing for the development of Amavata. Okay, so you have to, my intention here is to make you understand, or what carry home message you should have from this topic is, you will be able to treat n number of patients by understanding this 25th chapter, what is contributed by Madhavakara. And it's a very beautiful chapter to understand many things, to understand Kushta, to understand Tamakashwasa, to understand Udarda, Kota, and on the modern parlance, all the 1, 2, 3, 4 grades of hypersensitivity. So that's, this is an introduction and background for Amavata. So let's look as a sequence, what are the definitions. So anything, let it be pakshagata, let it be ardita, vatavadi, you need to understand the word meaning. Word meaning is going to give you certain impacts for the better treatment. Okay. Amena sahito vata, amavata, self-explanatory. Amam cha vatam cha, amavatam. So ama and vata, that conglomeration has to be felt and understood when you are speaking with the patient. What kind of expression the patient has. With that, you will be able to actually understand what was the intention behind writing these quotations. So let us look into another thing like amo apaka hetuha vataha swanama kyataha roga vishesha. So roga vishesha or the characteristics or the influence of the roga is the reason behind mentioning this word amavata. Okay, ama and vata, the basic necessities in the genesis of amavata. So that's just an information to make you understand that Triksandhi is the one where all you are going to see the circles, and it's not the sacrum in this context. You and in Ayurveda you are going to understand all context wise, right? So what is the Nidana? So let us look. As I got the feedback from the students, many of you are not having the book, so I tried to bring this quotation over here. So what it is, just I'll be reading, just go through that. Viruddhahara cheshtasya mandagner nischalasya snigdham uktavato hannam vyayamam kurvatastata. I think that is hannam, that is a spelling mistake. So that is anna. So I think many of these words are more familiar to you. Viruddha, the one which is not having a conglomeration with the body, the one which is not satme to the body, or the one which is not suitable to the body. There is n number of understanding behind this word viruddha. I think a person of dravyaguna might have explained regarding this viruddha, how 18 types of viruddha are existing on the earth, and how what you need to grasp from, say for example, virya viruddha, guna viruddha, or so many things are there, or prakriti viruddha, all that, how you need to understand from Nidana point of view is very important, and what they say from dravyaguna point of view need to be taken, need to be borrowed again. Okay, so viruddha is to be understood, and I think we have been telling regarding this, the viruddha word, where many examples are given, and I think you have been learning the example of fish and the milk and the ghee and the honey in equal quantity, and all those things you are learning. But what I say now is what we have to understand viruddha from the patient point of view, then only it is of some use for me. Otherwise, simply quoting the example, passing the exam is of no use. What I need to tell to the patient, what to be cut down and what to be adopted, and why did it to be cut down, I need to give a better justification. So what are the food items which happens to be viruddha in our daily routine? Indian diet. I don't want to say continental and the things, and I think you also don't want to do that. So what are the foods what we are eating in the form of viruddha now? Okay, I think the best example would be your dahi vada, where we have a famous restaurant in Belgium, so many like the Ajanta or where, which are very famous for dahi vada. Okay, so that is the best example. And you drink milkshakes. Okay, the milk which is having the madhura rasa. Okay, the fruits, you, whatever the seasonal fruits, every fruit has got an amla rasa. So they are virya viruddha. So in this way, you need to understand the viruddha. When the patient is sitting opposite to you, what all the food items he is taking from morning till night. So you need to write down and then find out what kind of viruddha is exhibited by each and every patient, whether the patient is of amavata, kushta, or autoimmune thyroiditis, or simple, what I can say, simply the, urticaria, whatever. Or the atopic dermatitis, the person is working in your what form, okay, where he is behind all those what I can say, domestic animals like the chicken, where he is suffering with autoimmune dermatitis, but he is always continuing with the same work nature. Then there is no treatment. He need to stop working in poultries first. Poultry is the causative thing in him to develop atopic dermatitis. You cannot treat him until he leaves that job. So similarly, you need to understand what kind of viruddha is there in a person who is sitting next to you. Okay, so that there are n number of things what I need to identify from my dietary things. Okay, so you have learned in your first year that a curd should not be eaten at night. What? Why you should not eat curd at night? You have asked the person who has told. Now you have carried that. What happens to be Virudha? That is the answer you need to find out. Okay, so Virudhahara, Virudha Cheshta. Virudha Cheshta is something wherein, say for example, in your Dinacharya, you have learnt in your Ashtanga Hridaya that after taking the food, you're not supposed to take the bath. Okay, that is happens to be the Virudha Vihara. So you are taking a heavy meal, you cannot swim, you cannot go for aerobics, you cannot go for Zumba. So I think you and your body will not allow you to do certain of the activities. Right, even your yoga cannot be done immediately after the food. They are the Virudha Cheshta. So there are n number of cheshta we are doing and we are actually adopting. Okay, so some of cheshta, say for example, the bright light syndrome. We all are with the screen now because of the lockdown and all, and you may be looking into many things. I think you are going to have the internals. So you may be reading and all, studying in fact, not reading. Okay, you may be studying. Okay, you might have opened your any of the screens at night with the lights off in the room and all. So there comes the role of this bright light and its syndrome, how it is going to cause a syndrome. So let's not bother deviate from the topic. So Cheshta is either Virudha or some other form. The Cheshta is going to afflict in one or the other way. So you come across Asatmendriya Artha Sanyoga. There is the example for this bright light syndrome. Ayoga, Atiyoga, Mithyayoga. Mithyayoga is the one where you need to put this bright light syndrome. Okay, so that's let it be. That let us push it aside from the Virudha Cheshta. So Virudhahara, Virudha Cheshta. Then what about this Mandagne? The person is having a diminished or lesser of this appetite. Or the Agni, let us not translate. It is Agni, is Agni, you understand? Okay, so in this context, it is not only the Jatar Agni, the other Agnis have got a role to play in this chronic disease like Amavata. So your Panchabhuta Agni, your Dhatva Agni, all have got a role to play here other than the Jatar Agni. That you need to understand. Okay, so in the context of Mandagni, you need to comment in this way, justify in this way. Then Nishchalasya, so the person is Nishchala. So there is no chala. Why there is no chala? There is alasyata. So there is no chala. The person who is standing always wants to sit. And after sitting, the person wants to lie down. Once lie down, no work. Okay. So there, how does the alasya? Let us not look into the cycle how the alasya is developed. But it is the nishchala that is end result of alasyata. And the alasyata is there in these people who are suffering, not as a part, but they will develop this alasyata as a clinical feature, right? And the reason is nischalasya. Okay, snigdham buktavato hanam vyayamam kurvatastata. Snigdham buktavato, so taking the food which is of more snigdha guna. So snigdha guna, I think you are a better person, you are understanding, you have learned the snigdha guna, which all ahara is going to possess this snigdha guna. Okay, so the anna which is possessing this snigdha, anna means not rice, it is the food, whatever you are consuming in accordance with your place where you are staying, the food what you are taking. Okay, so the snigdha. Okay, so snigdha bhojana, immediately after that vyayamam kurvatastata. So it is the vyayama. Word vyayama is used in those days, but now you varieties of vyayama. So playing video game is not vyayama, right? Okay, so your aerobics, swimming, okay, Zumba, and many things can be put under the heading of this vyayama. So after taking this snigdha bhojana, going for vyayama is one of the etiological factor for the production of this amavata. Okay, so it is not one day program. Okay, so Saturday evening we keep so many activities related with the sports. Okay, so you have consumed some puttu police, or you have taken heavy pineapple shira and you have come into the ground, you are playing and there is no amavata. Got it? It is a daily cycle wherein the person takes heavy food and then goes to swimming just to save the time, and in his timetable it is there. So that then only it will be a karana. Okay, so I hope I am very much clear in mentioning the etiological factors for the amavata. It is viruddhahara, viruddha chesta, it is the mandagni, it is the what I can say, the achala guna or the nishchala. Okay, and taking snigdha bhojana and then going for different viruddha cheshtas. So I feel that I'm able to, or I have conveyed you what are the ideological factors in the context of this what amavata. I think last week when I was dealing with Unmada also, I said something about this kind of viruddha food. So you don't know what food you are taking and what you are going to suffer in the future. Okay, because there are n number of contributions as a etiology, as a supporting factor, as a genetic factor. There are many things which will make you pose into a particular problem. Okay, everyone eating or everyone drinking milkshake is not going to suffer with amavata or with the kushta. They may suffer with autoimmune thyroiditis. They may suffer with infertility. So let's not bother. Why you need to screen the etiological factor is to be a better practitioner. Okay, you can just look certain of the things. Okay, nishchala, reduced appetite and heavy food items and the things. Okay, so before purva out angamarda aruchi trishna alasya gaurava jwara apaka shunata anganam amavatasya lakshanam. Okay, let us first look into some prapti and then come back to this purva rupa. So, as the name itself tells, the main role in the formation of samprapti is vata, okay, and the ama. So, I think the author in the text has said all these etiological factors, what I said, were for ama. And what about this vata? How does this vata gets a prakupita? In order to have a same stage like the ama, they have to be in equal quantity, what I said. Okay, so vata gets, I think if you screen again vata by this, there are some 6 to 7 line quotation is being mentioned for the vata prakopa. Okay, so common vata prakopa etiological factors, what are mentioned there, you need to carry them to this chapter also. So they are all making the vata also to enter into a stage of vriddhavastha, prakopavastha, utklishtavastha, or the different stages what the doshas reach. Right, so it is the ama and the vata which have reached to a particular stage, okay, to a particular level, to a particular configuration. I hope you are following me. Okay, ama and the vata have just come out of their normalcy, in the sense they have increased vriddhavastha, prakopavastha, utklishtavastha, where they are not able to maintain the normalcy, prakrutavastha or a health condition, rather they enter into a vikrutavastha. Then only they are able to produce a disease. So what happens once the vata prakopa is there? Okay, vayunam prerito hamaha shleshma sthanam pradavati. So what are the shleshma sthana in the sharira? I think you have dissected the whole body. You know where the shleshmasthana is. And in the physiology also, they have said, where is the shleshmasthana? And the shleshmasthana happens to be the, what I can say, there are n number again. So one among them is the joint. Okay. And you can see the pranavasrotas, which also has maximum amount of shleshma. Okay. Now there are other organs, but in this context you are seeing the shleshma sthana to be the sandhi. Okay, so the avayava is sandhi. Vayunam prerito hyamaha. So the ama gets prerana from the vata. Where is the movement in the body? In the body the movement is possible only with the help of vata. So this ama or the asatmeja bhava which is developed in the body has to move all over and produce the disease. But how it is moving? It needs something to carry. Okay, you all went your home with the flight, train and so many things. So the modality to travel here is with the help of vata. So the ama gets prerana with the vata and it pradavati, it moves into the sandhi. Shleshma sthana in this context is the sandhi. Vayunam prerito hyamaha shleshma sthanam pradavati tena atyartam vidagdo asau damaniha pratipadyate. Okay, So you are coming across a word Dhamani here. So in this context, Dhamani, I think in anatomy you have been learning this Dhamani as artery. Just come out of it. Here Dhamani is a synonym of Srotas. You have to understand Dhamani as synonym of Srotas in this context. Okay. So the Prerita Ama along with the Vata moves into the Sleshmasthana as Sandhi with the help of Dhamani. That is the, what I can say, with the help of Srotas. Different Srotas. There are n number of Srotas in the body. Every cell is considered as Srotas. I have been telling you many a number of times. Okay. So the one, the Ama which has entered a phase of Vidagdhavastha gets Prerana or moves along with the Vata into the Sleshmasthana through the Dhamanis. Okay. That's one thing. Vata Pitta Kafair Bhuyo Dushitaha So Annajo Rasaha. Vata Pitta Kafair Bhuyo Dushitaha So Annajo Rasaha. I think in your physiology they have said, they might have asked you a question. These doshas have to be nourished, or they are getting nourishment or not. Okay, as the time is short, I'll say the doshas get nourished with the food what we are taking. Okay, if all the things are fine, the doshas get nourished and you are in a healthy condition. But now that's not happening. Vata Pitta Kapha gets already have become dushita. So annajo rasa. So these dushita Vata Pitta Kapha does dushana to the anna rasa. Okay, so the anna rasa gets dushita, and this once anna rasa gets dushita, dushita anna rasa cannot actually, what I can say, do the poshana to the body. Rather, it carries the ama along with the vata pitta kapha and all. Srotaun sabishandayati nana varnav ati pichilaha. Srotaun sabishandayati. In the second line, he used the word dhamani. Now he is using the word srotaunsi. Srotam sabishandayati. You understand the word meaning of abhishandi. It's a very beautiful word which is used here. Abhishandi is the one where you can see that the ama which is moving into the srotas has attained such a phase that it has lost its movement and it is getting stagnated in the srotas because of the abhishandi guna which it is possessing. And this abhishandi guna is brought because of certain etiological factors. Okay. Nana varna vati pichilaha. So nana varna is the ama which is there. It attains the different things and the different forms due to the influence of pitta. There will be pitta varna. Because of vata, there will be aruna varna. Because of kapha, there will be sleshma varna. And pichilata. And you need to understand this word pichila, which again tells me that the contents in the srotas get stuck into the srotas. This pichilata is telling me that these contents or the asatmeja bhava, ama, along with the vata pitta kapha and with the prerana of vata, which is moving into the srotas to reach the target organ sandhi, okay, gets stagnated throughout the srotas because of the pichila guna, which is expressed by the contents in the srotas. That content is nothing but the ama. Okay. And because of the abhishandi guna, abhishandi and pichila happens to be an important factor in the formation of the samprapti. Okay. They are there in the srotas. So these people of amavata, they express something called as taimityata, which comes later on. This word you are going to see, this taimityata. I think in your first year you have learnt this taimitya, where the person might have said you that it is nothing but a person feels as though his body is covered with the buffalo skin because the guruta is felt by the person. The person feels more of heaviness. So a Kannada speaking patient tells that my yella vajjaga katit. So he is not active. He is always in a sleeping mode or he doesn't do any activity. Okay, that is just because of the stagnation of the contents of these takas throughout the srotas. Right? So only you are seeing the person when he sits, so he gets more of pain. But when he does the activities, the pain is relieved. So we call it as resting pain. Because these contents are already in the srotas, and when there is no movement, it is again supporting the thing to express more of the pain. So you need to ask the patient not to sleep during the day hours. Rather, you are asking him to do the activities. It is for this reason. ओके जनयंत्याशु दौर्बल्यम गौरवम हृदयस्य च व्याधिनामाश्रयो ह्याशः आमसंज्ञो अतिदारुणः ओके सो दौर्बल्य गौरव ओके एंड व्याधि नामाश्रयो ह्याशः आमसंज्ञो अतिदारुणः सो इट बिकम्स वेरी डिफिकल्ट टू ट्रीट एंड इट बिकम्स असाध्य okay and then you just look into this word yugapat kupitavanta strik sandhi praveshakau yugapat kupitavanta so all these together okay enter into strik sandhi praveshakau it doesn't mean that this ama and all is going to reach the sacrum or something in the beginning I was telling you strik sandhi here is to be understood as any joint which is comprising of two or three bones okay I think now it is clear why I was telling about the trik sandhi stabdam cha kuruto gatram mamavatah sa uchyate stabda the person becomes more stabda and he always sits in a place because of the pain because of the alasya guna which is developed in him due to the framed samprapti he is not alasi but he is becoming alasi because of the samprapti which is taking place in gatram mamavatam sa uchyate so I think this gist of this whole thing I'll just clear in two or three sentences so what you have to understand is in this context you have to I did not tell you the definition for ama and if you this is the chapter where you come across the word ama in a different direction at different understanding is given for the word ama otherwise you have been learning the ama from ashtanga hrudaya and at different context in rog nidan also okay beautifully the madhavakara has explained ama as something like it is annarasa so what you say undigested food or something when I ask you okay amam annarasam okay then he tells something like the sanchita mala the impacted stool which is there in the srotas that can also be considered as ama so three definitions he given in this context one is the sanchita mala okay one is the what I can say undigested food annarasa okay the undigested food okay and then the sanchita mala and then prathama dosha dushti so what exactly you mean by this word prathama dosha dushti okay just come out of this amavata let us go back to physiology what you learn there the food what we take the food what we take it moves into the adhvamashaya urdhvamashaya and then moves down so in the urdhvamashaya you are seeing the role of the kapha in the adhvamashaya you are seeing the role of the pitta okay and then it moves down again you are seeing the role of vata so all the three doshas are influencing the food what you are taking okay and at the same time the food what you are taking is nourishing the vata pitta kapha at different junctures that is at the adhvamashaya urdhvamashaya pakvashaya these three doshas get nourished at this point okay so otherwise if they are nourishing it's fine and good and the health is maintained on the contrary because of all these etiological factors what we are speaking now the dosha get dushita because of daily taking what I can say milkshakes in this hot summer okay there will be certain changes to the kapha okay so the kapha loses its configuration it gets dushita so very important and the third definition of ama need to be considered here and it is the prathama dosha dushti dushita dosha is also ama otherwise what I said the impacted stool or the undigested food material cannot move from the annavasrotas into the sandhi there is no such thing yes or no so in this context how I have need to explain you how the ama is carried to the joint then it is the dushita dosha which is being traveling from this annavasrotas into the mamsavasrotas asthivasrotas or sandhi proper I hope you understand it is the dushita dosha prathama dosha dushti just look into the commentary of the same chapter okay afterwards where you will come to know that is it is the annarasa it is the sanchita mala it is the prathama dosha dushti I need to consider the third definition in this context it is the Tushita dosha, which moves from annavasrotas due to the viruddhahara, vihara, cheshta, mandagni and all those things. These dushita doshas move into the sandhi, that is move into the trik sandhi with the help of damani, with the help of srotas. And when they are traveling along the srotas, they experience this abhishandhi and pichilata. The pichilata and abhishandhi, when expressed, you can see the person also expresses the alasi and all the, you are going to see the resting pain being expressed and so many things are there. I think the schematic diagram will be able to make you understand. So this you can see the viruddha ahara, vihara, manasika things like the chinta, shoka, bhaya, krodha, all these are responsible to produce the agni mandya. And this is the context where you can see the sanchaya. And then in between you can see the prakopa. This agni mandya lead to amavisha, samavata, and then shleshma sthana in the form through the damani, dushti into the tridoshas, and then how the exactly the amavata is produced. Dushita tridoshas move into the rasovasrotas or into the triksandhi. Daurbalata, Sandhishota, Shula and all you are seeing. So at the same time, it is possible to express the Kriyakala also. Okay. And let's go back to now the Purva Rupa. Thing just get refreshed. So we have just looked into the Nidana etiological factors. We have seen how these etiological factors land up into the samprapti, a beautiful pathophysiology, which will answer the other conditions as I have been telling many a number of times. Just because you're going to see n number of patients with understanding of this samprapti, a better treatment can be planned. Now look into the Purva Rupa. So I have said it is a disease of sandhis. But look at the Purva Rupas. Angamartha. So the person will have vague complaint. Understand Angamartha as Angamartha only. Don't translate it. So the person will have a typical feeling of Angamartha. He has some kind of pain he is not able to show. The whole body is having some kind of guruta that he cannot express. Then you have Aruchi, self-explanatory, Trishna, Alasya, Gaurava, Jvara, Apaka. Shunata Anganam Amavatasya Lakshanam. Shunata is the swelling. Apaka is there. I think you came across this word Apaka in the context of Unmada also. So you are going to see Trishna in so many diseases. How Trishna in context of Amavata is important, and in other diseases how Trishna is important. You do see the people coming to you saying the heights of Trishna, heights of thirst. The person will never feel satisfaction to drink water. They are just taking bottles of water. They are just drinking. Okay, they drink 500 ml, again drink, again drink. There is no satisfaction. The word meaning Trishna itself, the desire is so much that it is never completed. And you are going to see such a kind of thirst in people who are suffering with this Sjogren syndrome, where dryness of the mouth, dryness of the eyes and all is seen. Even the modern pathology can be put under this heading of Trishna. So you, the smallest thing, a person never comes to you saying that he's having thirst, he's having something like indigestion or no taste, aruchi. Just look into this word. Okay, this seems to be very simple but very difficult to identify in a patient, because they come after experiencing all this. Only when the joint pain starts, they come to you. You need to ask them whether they were suffering with all this just 6 months prior. Okay, so this is about the Purva Rupa. You need to say it's a very important thing again. And then let us look into the main cardinal features. We have seen the Nidana, we have seen the Samprapti, we have seen the Purva Rupa. Let us look into the Rupa. Hastapada Shirogulpa, Shirogulpa Janu Sanjanu. Okay, hasta, pada, shira, gulfa, trik, janu, uru, sandeshu. I think you have seen all the sandhis being mentioned here. So it is a multiple joint. Hasta. So on the other hand, I'm not going to say about the modern things related with this, where how the criteria is being mentioned and all. It's the hand joint, it's the foot joints, and anywhere you are going to see the joint, there all the patient is going to have the pain. Shira is being mentioned, where you have seen the skull, how they are, the bones are being joined. So that much is the severity. that much is the pain expressed by the patient. Okay, so trich, you don't understand as sacrum, you understand all these joints as trich sandhi. Okay, karoti hastapada shira gulfa trich janus uru sandhishu karoti sarujam shotam tatra dosha prapadyate. There is a typing mistake. Okay, karoti sarujam, there is pain, shota, swelling, yatra doshaha prapadyate. As and when these doshas start moving, prapadyate, then there all you are going to see the ruja and the shota. Pain is there, swelling is there. Once this asatmeja dushita doshas move from one joint to another. Okay, so fleeting type of joint pain and all you are going to come across in the context of rheumatic fever. Okay, so there you get explanation for that even in this context. Got it? Sa desho rujyate atyartham vyavid eva vrashchikai. Sa desho rujyate ityartham vyavid eva vrashchikai. Sa desho rujyate, desha here have to be understood as the local area, different areas. In the sense, the asatmeja bhava, where it is moving, if it is moving into the hand joints, it has even covered the knee joint, which all joints it is going to move, there it is going to produce a kind of pain called as vrashchika damshavat vedana. So vrashchika damshavat vedana and all you are not seeing immediately once the patient suffers with a condition like amavata, or label him as amavata, no, you cannot see, or you cannot wait till the patient tells you that there is a scorpion sting like pain. You cannot wait, you have to diagnose even with the two or three complaints. At a later stage, the person is going to suffer with such a severe kind of pain where a simile is given to vrashchika damshavat vedana. So in your MCQs or in your viva, the person may ask you, vrashchika damshavat vedana is seen in which kind of patients? So it is the patient of amavata. Okay, janayet, so agni daurbalyam praseko aruchi agauram. So I had been telling you that it is a disease of musculoskeletal system, but you are going to see the other features being expressed and troubling the patient more, like janet. So agni daurbalyam praseka aruchi gaurava happens to be the worst thing what they are suffering. Utsaha hani, there is no utsahani just because of the ongoing alasya which is there. Vairasyam daham bahumutratam. So bahumutratam is a very important terminology explained here. Why bahumutrata is there? What exactly happens? It is again the nature of the disease because of which you are going to see the bahumutrata. There is no other thing why this bahumutrata is there. Okay, so you can ask the history to the patient. There is bahumutrata, or there is change in or sudden drift in the quantity, quality and episodes of what I can say, micturition. Bahumutrata. Okay, kukshav katinatam shulam tata nidra viparyam. Nidra viparya is a very important terminology where the person will feel more of day sleep. He feels more sleepy at daytime. At night he is not sleeping because of the pain. So nidra viparyaya. Viparya is telling me something. There is alteration in the sleep pattern. This you are not going to see in any other diseases. So any samprapti which is understood on the form what we have studied today, there you can find out this pattern of nidra viparya. Trichardi brahma murcha rudgraham bid vibaddatam. So these small terms which are being explained as rudgraha, vid vibhadata, trishna, chardi, brahma, murcha. So the person is even going to reach brahma and murcha and the coma. So it is involving the multiple systems, not only the musculoskeletal system. So whenever a patient of amavata comes, simply don't write gugulu, gugulu, gugulu and all. You need to treat all these features. So to treat all these features, you need to concentrate first on agni. It is not only the Jataragni, you need to treat on the Dhatvagni, you need to treat on the Mahabhutagni. Wherein your one prescription should be on the lines of Agni first. Wherever your patient is suffering with any kind of autoimmune disorders. So let me not go back again through this. I think I'm able to complete the etiology, sorry, this cardinal features or the Pratyatma Lakshanas or the Rupa. Signs and symptoms both are being mixed here. That again you just see. Okay. Okay, scorpion sting just highlighted to make you remember the thing, because whenever it is a vaivahosa or MCQ, you need to understand. Okay, the sleep pattern is changed. That's a thing where the people are just sleeping during the day. It is not their fault. It is the disease and its influence. Okay, and then you have the person tries to, he is not sleeping at night. Okay, it is because of the pain. The picture may not be exactly simulating in the for the Ratri Charya. Okay, this is the chronic stage. Jadayantra, Jadya, Antra Kujana, Anaha, Kashtascha, Anya, Anupadravan, Anyan Upadravan, Sankocha, Kanja, Tvadinam. So Kanja, Pangu and all you have studied there. Whatever Samprapti is responsible there for the production of Kanja and Pangu and all, you are seeing it as a deformity or the Upadrava. Okay, so n number of Upadrava you are seeing. So it is Upadrava means not only deformity to the joint as it is a musculoskeletal disorder, but you are seeing that Jadyata. So Alasyata, Guruta, Jadyata are the different phases. So that has continued till the Upadrava stage also. So whenever if you are feeling Alasyata, Nidra Viparayanal, just think on this line and just click on these things and just think whether you are into a phase of development of autoimmunity, Asatmeja Bhava in the Sharira, and how to throw it. Some kind of, or I can say the Shodhana and all. What better modality to be adopted to come out of this initial phase of Jadyata or Guruta or the Sthaimityata and all. Okay, then, so these are the Upadravas or the complications. So the relieving, how to diagnose Amavata without any laboratory investigations, history taking. Actually, with the history taking, many of the diagnoses are done. Okay. So Surya Meghodaya Nishi is the term I think you have learnt in your Ashtangurudaya. Surya, the sunrise will relieve the pain. Meghodaya Nishi. Meghodaya, Nishi Udaya. So Nishi Udaya is, you have to understand in this way, Nishi is the night. At the start of the night, that is after sunset, once the night begins. So Surya Meghodaya Nishi, Suryodaya, Meghodaya, Nishi, Udaya. So Suryodaya, morning stiffness is the term which I'm trying to bring it here in the context of Suryodaya. Meghodaya, clouds. On a cloudy day, the person feels more of lethargic, more of sleepy, more of see, more of stiffness kind of thing, more of Guruta, more of Sthaimityata, feels as if he will sleep. Experience that. So you have taken 2-3 polis and now is the season of mango. Your mother may be preparing many dishes out of mango and poli or polige, what we call, I don't know. Okay, and all that you are eating and you just click on the 3 o'clock class and then take a nap. If you have taken 2-3 mango or many different foodstuffs, there you can understand how exactly a person feels more of lethargic and what I can say, heaviness and all can be felt. That a person, healthy person feels in that way. What about the Vikruta or a diseased one? Okay. So once the Meghodaya, cloudy days will make him suffer more. Nishi, in the evening, the person feels more of the things. Upashaya or Anupashaya that need to be utilized. Anupashaya is the oil or the abhyanga. So if you just put any kind of oil, the real coconut oil also, the person feels more of stiffness and the things are increased. Okay, that will help you to diagnose. Okay, so upashaya in the form like the valuka or the warm heat. So when you see swedana, there are n number of kinds, like the wet swedana or the steam and all. It's the dry swedana. So something, a cloth just put on a tava and just put on a joint, the person feels more relief. That is upashaya. So there are many things you can diagnose with the history taking and some of the things what the person is doing with. Okay, Samprapti we have seen. Okay, and there are types like Vataja, Pittaja, Kapaja and the Sannipataja. And the Lakshanas as usual, Pittatsa, Daha, Raga. So if the Pitta is more, so the burning sensation is more. Raga, discoloration is seen in and around the joints. Sa Shulam, Pavananugam. If the Vata is of more in integrity and its configuration is increased, then Shula is expressed more rather than Daha and Raga. Sthaimitya Guru Kandu. Sthimitata, you please understand what it is. And a very beautiful word which will explain many other diseases. Okay. Guru Kandu Kapha Dushtam Tamadishet. Okay. This is because of the influence of Kapha. Sadhya Sadhata, एक दोष जसाध्य द्विदोष जयाप्य सर्व देह चर शोत स कृच्र सन्निपातिक. So sannipata javarity, where you are going to swelling all over the body, all over the joints, that happens to be the kashtasadhya or asadhya. And overall the people say that amavata is asadhya, but you can see amavata getting treated and the complaints have never appeared back. So the it is ekadoshaja. And we have seen in the OPD, we have treated patients with amavata depending on what stage they are coming and how is the genetic predisposition, how is the family history. Depending on that, you can treat. Stress need to be relieved in any disease for that matter, that is more concentrated in the context of amavata. Okay, thank you.
Thank you.